We all know about the turmoil in the Red Sea right now due to the war. But did you know that the Bible says the Leviathan lives in the Euphrates River close by, and that God is putting hooks in his jaw to draw him out? This is the same seven-headed beast as described in the book of Revelation. Let's examine the scriptures about him and put this puzzle together. Can you draw out Leviathan with a fish hook, or press down his tongue with a cord? Can you put a rope in his nose, or pierce his jaw with a hook? Will he make many pleas to you? Will he speak to you soft words? Will he make a covenant with you to take him for your servant forever? Will you play with him as with a bird, or will you put him on a leash for your girls? Will traders bargain over him? Will they divide him up among the merchants? Job, chapter 41, verses 1 through 6. Who has first given to me that I should repay him? Whatever is under the whole heaven is mine. I will not keep silence concerning his limbs, or his mighty strength, or his goodly frame. Who can strip off his outer garment? Who would come near him with a bridle? Who can open the doors of his face? Around his teeth is terror. His back is made of rows of shields, shut up closely as with a seal. One is so near to another that no air can come between them. They are joined one to another. They clasp each other and cannot be separated. His sneezings flash forth light, and his eyes are like the eyelids of the dawn. Out of his mouth go flaming torches. Sparks of fire leap forth. Out of his nostrils comes forth smoke, as from a boiling pot and burning rushes. His breath kindles coals, and a flame comes forth from his mouth. In his neck abides strength, and terror dances before him. The folds of his flesh stick together, firmly cast on him and immovable. His heart is hard as a stone, hard as the lower millstone. When he raises himself up, the mighty are afraid. At the crashing, they are beside themselves.
Here's the key. Most people, when they want to understand Leviathan, they don't go to the Psalms.
Yet God my King is from of old, working salvation in the midst of the earth. You divided the sea by your might. You broke the heads of the sea monsters on the waters. You crushed the heads of Leviathan. You gave him as food for the creatures of the wilderness. You split open springs and brooks. Psalm chapter 74, verses 12 through 15.
Psalm 74 and Isaiah 27 are two passages that describe Leviathan and give further insight.
In that day, the Lord, with his hard and great and strong sword, will punish Leviathan the fleeing serpent, Leviathan the twisting serpent, and he will slay the dragon that is in the sea. Isaiah chapter 27, verse 1.
So we put a list right here so you can see all the attributes according to Job 41. He's indestructible. He breathes fire. He's the king out of all of those who are proud. That's going to come back later. He lives in the sea. His back is made of rows of shields and his heart is of stone.
This made me think of the black stone that's in the heart of the Kaaba that the Muslims circulate around. And I also noticed how Mecca is at the center of the Red Sea as well.
Leviticus 26:1 from the Holy Bible says, "Ye shall make you no idols, nor graven image, neither rear you up a standing image, neither shall ye set up any image of stone in your land to bow down unto it, for I am the Lord your God."
So, the heart of Leviathan is a stone. The Hindus also have a similar stone. They claim the Muslims took a lot of their rituals, actually. The black stone also encompasses the financial world that controls everything. Have you heard of the company called BlackRock? It's an American global investment corporation based in New York City. It has become the world's largest asset manager with $5.98 trillion in assets. Do you know that the Muslims think that this stone will come alive in the last days, and on Judgment Day have two eyes and a tongue to speak? So it can testify at the last day? Sounds kind of like the image of the beast, doesn't it?
The black stone shall come on the Day of Judgment with two eyes that he will be able to see with, and a tongue that will be able to speak out with, in order to testify for the favor of those who will touch it with the truth, understanding that it is just a stone. But it will be a sign that they have come to perform Hajj or Umrah and visit the ancient house.
Oh, but it's just a stone, right? Yeah. No thanks. I think I'll have Jesus speak for me on Judgment Day. I imagine the heartbeat of this serpent to sound kind of like the tune that's playing. Why is the Kiswa covering black? Oh, of course, it's tied into ancient Saturn worship. You know, it kind of reminds me of how they go around the Kaaba in circles, is sort of like, you know, the rings go around Saturn. Kind of reminds me of that. The documentation in the video explains it way better than I can. Of course, the Muslims will deny it has anything to do with ancient Saturn worship, but do you know that it's documented in the Bible? Stephen the Martyr mentioned it when he was being stoned to death. He accused the Jews of worshipping Chion, the star of their god Remphan. So you see, it goes way back, it's very ancient. Leviathan's heart of stone is at the heart of all idolatrous worship, including the worship of money. It's just not present in Islam, it's also present in Judaism. It's represented by their star, which is the star of Remphan or Chayun, which means Saturn. It's not really the Star of David. As you can see from the graphic above, it didn't even represent the Jewish people until the 17th century. Gee, I wonder who picked out the symbol. Muslims will often point the finger at Israel for the Star of David, screaming Zion conspiracy. Yet the Kaaba itself is the same, depicted in the form of a six-sided cube, in which they pray with their backs towards Jerusalem. I think these two religions are just inverted copies of one another.
The Book of Revelation says, "Here is wisdom. Let him who has understanding calculate the number of the beast, for the number is that of a man, and his number is 666.
Amos chapter 5. You shall take up Sikuth your king, and Kiyun your star god, your images that you made for yourselves. Stephen mentions the god Raphan to be associated with the noted star. Stephen was quoting from the Septuagint, which is the Greek version of the Old Testament, the Tanakh. As we see in the Hebrew scriptures, Raphan is the god Kiyun. Kiyun is dominantly believed by scholars to be the god of Saturn. In Strong's, probably a statue of the Assyrian Babylonian god of the planet Saturn, and used to symbolize Israelite apostasy. And other lexicons also agree. The name of an idol worshipped by the Israelites in the wilderness, i.e., the planet Saturn. So the Israelites created an image of a star to represent the planet Saturn and incorporated it into their worship. According to the prophets, this was very bad, not...
The black stone that the Muslims revere in the Kaaba was a meteorite, a fallen star.
Yeah. Whatever this beast is, I mean, we have an image right here. It's a hydra. It's a multiple-headed beast from the sea. That's what we have to understand. Now, here's another key is when we go to Isaiah 27, okay? This is a messianic prophecy about Leviathan. We're going to go into what that signifies, but this is what Isaiah 27 says. It says, in that day, the Lord with his severe sword, great and strong, will punish Leviathan, the fleeing serpent. He will slay the dragon in the sea.
Right.
So we see, brother, that, I mean, this is clearly messianic. This is clearly in the last days. This is clearly talking about in that day, the day of the Lord. This is when he will punish Leviathan, who is currently in the sea. And the other key point here is that Leviathan is described as a dragon. That's what he's described as. So he's not a kraken. He's not a fish, a crocodile. He's a multiple-headed dragon. That's what he is. Okay. Yep. So this is ultimately the key right here, right? Leviathan is a multiple-headed dragon that dwells in the sea. So we see right here, Leviathan is ultimately slain in the day of the Lord, in the last days, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's so clear. It's literally like the clearest thing. So we're going to put up some parallel passages here.
For this is the day of the Lord God of hosts, a day of vengeance, that he may avenge him of his adversaries, and the sword shall devour, and it shall be satiate and made drunk with their blood. For the Lord God of hosts hath a sacrifice in the north country by the river Euphrates. Then we have Zephaniah 1:7. Be silent before the Lord God, for the day of the Lord is near. The Lord has prepared a sacrifice and consecrated his guests.
Why are they saying that there's a sacrifice that the Lord has consecrated in the last days for his guests? What is the sacrifice that he's prepared? That's what we're going to go into.
Yeah.
Because when you compare, I want you guys to look at this. We have the Leviathan verses on the right side, and we have the Day of the Lord verse on the left. So if you look at the yellow text, we've actually put the text side by side. In Jeremiah, for this is the day of the Lord, the God of hosts, a day of vengeance. Within Isaiah 27, on the right side, it says, in that day, the Lord with his severe sword will punish Leviathan. What does it say in Jeremiah 51? And the sword shall devour. It shall be satiate and make drunk with their blood. So you see, it's the day of the Lord. The sword is mentioned. And then if you go to Psalm 74, that speaks about you crushed God, the heads of Leviathan. You gave him as food for the creatures of the wilderness. Mm. What is he doing in Psalm 74 when he slays him? He's given him as food, a sacrificial offering.
As a sacrifice.
That's what he's doing. And so you look at Jeremiah, the God of hosts have a sacrifice in the north country by the river Euphrates. Let's actually continue. So here is the ultimate question. I love this question, guys. Here's a question for you to really think about this. What multiple-headed beast or dragon that lives in the sea is killed by God in the last days? Do you know of any besides Leviathan? Does anybody know about this beast? It is ultimately the beast of Revelation, okay? That is, it's literally the same beast, okay? So let's take a brief look. So within Revelation 12, we see that another sign appeared in heaven. And behold, a great red dragon with seven heads, multiple-headed, and 10 horns. And on his head, seven diadems. His tail swept down a third of the stars of heaven and cast them to the earth, okay? Then what does John see? He sees another beast coming out of the sea with 10 horns and seven multiple heads. It had crowns on its horns, and on each head it had a blasphemous name. This is according to Revelation 13. Okay. Now we ultimately learn that this beast, the sea beast, that arose after the dragon, he looks like a leopard, had the feet of a bear and the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave the beast his great power, throne, and authority. That is, you have to remember that the dragon, he comes from above, so he falls and he sweeps the stars down. He's coming from above. The second beast, the beast that arises from the sea, he's coming from the sea, from below, right? So there's a difference between these two creatures, but ultimately what the dragon does when he comes from heaven is he gives his authority to the sea beast that arises from the sea. So for the period of the tribulation and you know, the last time on the earth, as it was in the days of Noah, this sea beast will be acting with the authority of Satan. He will be the ultimate beast that God has to come and slay and destroy, okay? Now, what we want to do is we want to show you the parallels between the verses of Leviathan and the sea beast, because we're going to show, I mean, we're just like literally making a key bulletproof case, because it's undeniable when you compare them like this. Okay. So the first parallel that obviously you've seen, we're going to show, is that both of these beasts are multiple headed beasts from the sea. So in Revelation 13, The dragon stood on the shore of the sea, and I saw a beast coming out of the sea with 7 heads and 10 horns. Within Psalm 74, it was you, God, who split open the sea. By your power, you broke the head of the monster of the waters, and it was you who crushed the heads of Leviathan. Same story.
Multiple-headed,
right?
Yeah.
Another parallel is that they are described as unstoppable. Revelation 13, people worshiped the dragon who came from above because he gave his authority to the beast of the sea. And they worshiped the beast of the sea and asked who is like this beast and who can wage war against it. He's unstoppable. Within Job 41, going back to the original verse, it says, any hope of subduing it is false. The mere sight of it is overpowering. Who then is he who can stand before me? Nothing on earth is its equal. Creature without fear. Are you starting to see the parallels here, guys?
Yeah, big parallels. Yeah.
And deeper. So Leroy, he is also the embodiment of pride, correct?
Yeah, correct. In Revelation 13, it describes the beast was given a mouth to utter proud words and blasphemies and to exercise its authority for 42 months.
And so, you know, those are really good parallels, the first three, but this fourth one really nails the nail on the head, right? Because this one is one you really can't escape. The final parallel that we're going to talk about is that both of these creatures are defeated by God on the last day. So within Revelation 19, towards the end of the book of Revelation, it says that the sea beast was captured and with it the false prophet. The two of them were thrown alive into the fiery lake of burning sulfur. Okay. In Psalm 74, we've already described this, how he will slay the dragon in the sea in the day of the Lord, in that day. Okay, it's a messianic prophecy.
This sea monster has an actual name, Rahab. It is Hebrew and means a mystical sea monster. It's the emblematic or poetic name for Egypt and for the Red Sea. Also, it is the Hebrew word for the abyss.
He is literally given a name within the Jewish understanding and within the Psalms as Rahab. So watch what we do when we connect everything together, right? Because when you look throughout the Psalms, there's a mysterious monster that is described as Rahab that is ultimately destroyed by God. In Psalms 89, verse 10, it says, you crushed Rahab like one of the slain. With your strong arm, you scattered your enemies. Okay, so you're like, you're reading the psalm. Who's Rahab? What's going on here? I don't understand. If you go down to Isaiah 51, which is messianic, this is in the messianic portion of Isaiah, it says this, awake, awake, arm of the Lord. Clothe yourself with strength. Awake as in days gone by, as in generations of old. Was it not you who cut Rahab to pieces? You pierced that monster through. You see what I'm saying? Right. Yeah. And I mean, we're even looking, like, even if you want more evidence of this, the name is given within Job as well. So in Job 26, this is about 15 chapters before Job 41, which is where Leviathan is mentioned. He's called Rahab. So by his power, he churned up the sea. By his wisdom, he cut Rahab to pieces. Remember when we were talking about the great sacrificial offering of Leviathan? Right, where he's going to give him as food to this is the imagery. He's cutting him to pieces. He defeats him in the bottomless pit, and he's given him as food for the creatures of the earth. So again, let's look at this name, because this is going to give us more insight within the Hebrew, which is Rahav, right? There's different kind of ways of saying it. It is used in the Hebrew Bible to indicate pride or arrogance, a mythical sea monster, Leviathan. It is also an emblematic or poetic name for Egypt and for the sea. Okay, so remember the Red Sea region, Egypt, it's all within kind of this, you know, this area. Very interesting. Rahab is also one of the Hebrew words for the abyss. Okay, all connected, guys. You guys should all see how this is all just like, we're putting it on the map for you to connect so that when we get to the final conclusion of this video, it'll ultimately blow your mind.
The Hebrew word for bottomless pit is Tehom, which means the depth, the primeval ocean, the subterranean waters, or the Red Sea, which, by the way, is currently at war. The English word bottomless pit, translated into the Greek, is abyss, which means the deep sea or the underworld.
Yeah, that was the really good find that it literally says right here that it could also, according to the Hebrew, mean the Red Sea specifically, which for those who don't know, the Red Sea is on the Arabian Peninsula, which is kind of what our channel talks about. where the beast is going to come from. That's kind of a side note, but it's something definitely we have to talk about, which is really interesting. The key here really is that you have to understand is that the bottomless pit equals the abyss, which equals the sea. Okay, these terms are synonymous to home. This is what they mean. So when you look at the Septuagint as well, which is the bottom part of this, it's translated as abyssos or abyssos, right? Yeah, it is literally the same thing, the deep or the underworld. So when we say that this beast is rising out of the sea, it's rising out from the abyss, the bottomless pit, right? Mm. Revelation gives us even more information, because when you go to Revelation 9, we have even more of the story that's happening when the angel comes down with the key and unlocks the bottomless pit. So it says right here in Revelation 9, verses 1 through 3, "And the fifth angel blew his trumpet." This is during the trumpet judgments. "And I saw a star fallen from heaven to earth, and he was given the key to the shaft of the abyssos, the bottomless pit, the sea. He opened the shaft of the bottomless pit, and from the shaft rose smoke, like a smoke of a great furnace." Okay? "The sun and the air were darkened, and from the smoke came from the shaft, there was locusts." So in verse 3, "Then from the smoke came locusts on the earth, and they were given power like the power of scorpions on the earth. These locusts that arise from the bottomless pit, they were told not to harm the grass of the earth or any green plant or any tree, but only those people who do not have the seal of God on their foreheads. They were allowed to torment them for 5 months, but not to kill them. And their torment was like the torment of a scorpion when it stings someone." What's probably the most interesting about this is that these locusts actually have as king over them a specific being. Now, this is where a lot of Christians get lost, because it says right here, "The appearance of the locusts were like horses prepared for battle." We kind of skip down a bit, and it says, verse 11, "They have as king over them the angel of the bottomless pit. His name in Hebrew is Abaddon, and in Greek he is called Apollyon." So the mistake we see a lot of Christians make is they try to like correlate Apollyon with Apollo or Abaddon with a specific demon or something like that. Guys, these are just titles. This is a title, okay? So his name in Hebrew is Abaddon. That's a title. And in Greek, he is called Apollyon. Yeah. So two different names in two different languages. They're supposed to represent something. So Abaddon, in the Hebrew, what does the name mean? It means the place of destruction. So this is where he's coming from. He's coming from the place of destruction. And the Greek title, Apollyon, literally means the destroyer.
Right.
So it's Abaddon or Apollyon, whatever that is. Basically, what this is signifying is that this angel, when he rises out of the bottomless pit, he's going to be king over these locusts, and he's going to be the king of the host, and he is ultimately the greatest destroying angel this world has ever seen. So here is where it starts to get crazy. This is where the real connection is about to be made. I put the visuals up here, right? So you can see how they're connected. So on the left, you have Leviathan equals Rahab, the demon of the sea. On the right, the sea beast equals Apollyon, the Antichrist, the king of the bottomless pit. So they are both the beast of the sea. They are both king of the abyss. They are both slain by God in the last day. So therefore, they are the same being, from different time periods. Okay. So I want us to look at the verses again so we can connect all this together. And again, these slides will be available for you guys on my Patreon for free. You can become a free member, access the slides. You can teach this, use this, whatever you want. We're not going to make you pay. Just go ahead and use it if you like. So within Leviathan, he says in Psalm 74, "You divided the sea by your might. You broke the heads of the sea monsters on the water. You crushed the heads of Leviathan." Okay, Isaiah 59. "Awake, awake, arm of the Lord." This is Christ. "Clothe yourself with strength. Awake, as in days gone by, as in generations of old. Was it not you who cut Rahab to pieces, who pierced that monster through?" Same thing. Okay. Yep. And then look at the ultimate messianic application in Isaiah 27. "In that day, the day of the Lord, with his hard and great and strong sword, will he punish Leviathan, the fleeing serpent, Leviathan, the twisting serpent, and he will slay the dragon that is in the sea." Okay. Now, let's paint this picture according to Revelation. So we've used the same pictures because they're the same being, but we're using the Revelation imagery. Okay. So on the left-hand side, "The dragon stood on the shore of the sea, and I saw a beast coming out of the sea with 7 heads, 10 horns. Okay. They have as king over them the angel of the bottomless pit. His name in Hebrew is Abaddon. In Greek, he's called Apollyon. This just means destroyer. Okay. And the beast that you saw was, is not, and is about to rise from the bottomless pit and go to destruction.
Destruction, yeah.
Okay. Who destroys the king of the bottomless pit, the beast from the sea in the last days?
Christ.
That's what he does.
Yeah.
Right?
Yep.
Yeah.
That's right. So it's the same thing, like throughout, even just going through it, it's just, it's undoubtable, you know?
Absolutely, yeah. Brother.
It's very solid.
And even right here, do you want to go over the names, this slide right here?
Yeah, so we're going to go over the names of the beast here. So we have first the beast of the sea, that's in Revelation. We have him called Leviathan in the book of Job, Rahab in the Psalms, and Abaddon, Apollyon the Destroyer, that's in Revelation, the Angel of the Abyss, again, Revelation 9, and the Antichrist. It all boils down to this individual. He has so many descriptions about him in the Old Testament, and you know, we're just harmonizing it. Now, Leviathan is his other identity that not many people have like put it together, but we can clearly see that it's describing the same being all along.
Yeah. And this is one of those things, again, so like we've really painted this picture for you. You guys might have to go back and really soak this in, really go back and really try to understand what we're saying. It can get really confusing because what we're doing is we're taking all these scriptures and harmonizing them together and painting this overall picture. So you might get lost. Just go back, try to trail and come all the way back up to this point, right? And hopefully the Holy Spirit reveals this to you, because when the Holy Spirit reveals to you that this being, this entity, who's described with many different names throughout the scripture, is the number one enemy of God throughout all of the scriptures, it's the same person, you can piece together who he is, what he's going to do, where he's coming from, what's going to happen, it becomes super clear. So ultimately, this bottom point, each of these beings are described as in the abyss, will rise again in the last days, and will be slain by God. But here is the revelation of this video. There is also another name for this being, right? There is one more name. Actually, there's more, but there's one really important name that's going to connect it for you. So here is the question. What other name does the scripture speak about that connects to this beast, this being? Amos 7. This is key. It's the same figure, Leroy. Amos 7.
So this is going to tie everything up. It's going to tie everything up. So we have Amos 7, verse 1. Again, this is in the Septuagint for those who have other translations. It mentions this very key in the Septuagint. Thus has the Lord God showed me, and behold, a swarm of locusts, right? So we see locusts in Revelation coming from the east, and behold, one caterpillar, King Gog. So that's the name, guys. King Gog. It literally ties him as the king of the locust army.
Yeah. I mean, it's as clear as day, right? It's seriously as clear as day. It is another name for this being is Gog of Magog, right? So if Apollyon is described as coming out of the abyss, he's going to lead a swarm of locusts, which are symbols for something. Mm-hmm. And he is the king of this locust army. So is Gog. In Amos 7, he's leading this swarm of locusts against Jerusalem. He's described as devouring the grass of the land.
Exactly.
Right. So he comes against Israel. He's devouring the grass of the land. He's devouring a destroying spirit. That's what he is. Yep. And I said, Lord God, be merciful. Who shall rise up Jacob? For he is small in number. See what we're saying? So it's the same exact story. These are all the same exact being. Gog of Magog, Apollyon, the beast of the sea, Leviathan, and Rahab are one. So once you understand this, it makes sense of certain verses about Gog that people try to make up these weird theories, right? So for instance, in Ezekiel 38, why is Gog described as having hooks in his jaws and being drawn out by God?
Exactly.
Now you understand. So the word of the Lord came to me, son of man, set your face toward Gog of the land of Magog, the chief prince. Remember, chief prince is always used as, in angelic terms. He's the chief prince of Meshach and Tubal, and prophesy against him and say, thus says the Lord God, behold, I am against you, O Gog, chief prince of Meshach and Tubal. I will turn you about and put hooks in your jaws, and I will bring you out with all of your army, horses and horsemen. What does Job 41 say? Can you pull in Leviathan with a fish hook, or tie down its tongue with a rope? Can you put a cord through its nose, or pierce its jaw with the hook? It makes sense. It harmonizes. Now, not only does the hooks in the jaw start to make sense, he's also described as the king of the host. So in Ezekiel 38, be ready and keep ready, you and all of your hosts that are assembled about you, and be a guard for them. After many days, this is the last days, you will be mustered in the latter years. You will go against a land that is restored from war. So remember, Gog, when he comes against Israel, he's described as having a cloud. He's going to be like a cloud covering the land. Yeah. He's going to be like a cloud covering the land. All of the armies are going to come in and invade. It's going to be a massive destroying army. Okay? Amos 7, this is what it says within the Septuagint, which is the earlier translation, the much more reliable translation. Thus has the Lord God showed me, and behold, a swarm of locusts coming from the east, and behold, one caterpillar, King Gog. And it came to pass when he had finished devouring the grass of the land that God will deal with him. Okay, same imagery. Within Revelation 9, look at what it says. The appearance of these things were as locusts. They were like horses prepared for battle. On their heads were what looked like crowns of gold. Their faces were like human faces. They have as king over them the angel of the bottomless pit. Okay,
yeah.
It's all connected.
Connected, right? Yeah.
Not only that, he is described as the king of the north. Okay, where does God come from? You will come from your place out of the uttermost parts of the north, you and many peoples with you, all of them riding on horses, a great host, a mighty army. Within Jeremiah 51, right? This is the day of the Lord, the God of hosts, a day of vengeance, that he may avenge him of his adversaries. For the Lord God has a sacrifice in the north country, in the river Euphrates. We're going to make sense of what the sacrifice is at the end, because that's probably the best piece of evidence there. But there's something happening in the north country in the day of the Lord that God comes to judge. Right now, do you want to show them the Daniel connection, brother?
Yeah, Daniel says that this individual is going to be the king of the north. When you read Daniel 11 verse 21 onwards, it's describing this final antichrist, and it actually places him, it tells us that he's in the north parts, right, specifically by the Euphrates River. Right, this is what ties him to the Assyrian. And yeah, not only that, obviously in a separate series we're going to go into detail about the Assyrian, but Daniel 11 mentions him as the Scythians will come against him. It's the same thing in Numbers 24. Yeah. The Scythians come against this individual called Asher, or the Assyrian. So it all ties up. That's a separate point, but yeah, we'll go to it at some point.
Yeah, and yeah. Same here, he's literally called the king of the north with a Daniel. Yeah. So we have three separate witnesses. In Daniel, he's described as the king of the north. He's going to return to his own country with great wealth. His heart shall be set against the Holy Covenant, and he will take action against it and then return, to his own country. Okay. Mm-hmm. So all of these beings are described as the king of the north. So if you're not even convinced by that, like just the overwhelming testament of scripture, the overwhelming amount of connections, look at what Ezekiel 38 says as well in verse 38 and 17. Thus says the Lord God, are you, Gog, he of whom I spoke about in former days by my servants, the prophets of Israel, who in those days prophesied for years that I would bring you against them? Okay, so what God is saying is like, dude, have I not said for years to the other prophets like Amos, when I called you King Gog, who controls the locust armies, are you not the one who in the last days will come against my people Israel? I told them you will come against them, right? That's what he's saying. Okay, who comes against Israel in Revelation? Apollyon with his horde.
Apollyon,
who comes against Israel in Ezekiel 38? Gog and his horde. Who comes against within the Psalms, Israel? It's Leviathan, right?
So
super clear. But even if that is not clear enough for you, we have two more parallels that will continue to make this point. So remember, we talked about the sword that's going to slay Leviathan in the sea, the bottomless pit, in the last days. What does it say in Ezekiel 38? I will summon a sword against Gog. On all my mountains, declares the Lord God, every man's sword shall be against his brother. With pestilence and bloodshed, I will enter into judgment with him. In Isaiah 27, this is the parallel. In that day, the Lord with his hard and great and strong sword will punish Leviathan, the fleeing serpent, Leviathan, the twisting serpent. He will slay the dragon that is in the sea. Look at Revelation. The beast was captured, the sea beast, and the rest were slain by the sword that came from the mouth of him who was sitting on the horse. Guys, please,
same thing.
Listen to scripture. Same thing. All of the birds were gorged with their flesh. All right. So the final connection we're going to make, so that you can understand that Gog is this being described in scripture, is the sacrificial offering. The most clear connection that could possibly be made. Yeah. So within Ezekiel 39, here's the verse on the screen, brother. What does it say about the sacrificial offering?
You shall fall on the mountains of Israel, you and all your hordes and the peoples who are with you. I will give you to birds of prey of every sort and to the beasts of the field to be devoured. You shall fall in the open field, for I have spoken, declares the Lord God.
And it continues in Ezekiel 39. Yep.
Assemble and come, gather from all around to the sacrificial feast that I am preparing for you, a great sacrificial feast on the mountains of Israel, and you shall eat flesh and drink blood. You shall eat the flesh of the mighty and drink the blood of the princes of the earth, of rams, of lambs, and of he-goats, of bulls, all of them fat beasts of Bashan. And you shall eat fat till you are filled, and drink blood till you are drunk, at the sacrificial feast that I am preparing for you. And you shall be filled at my table with horses and charioteers, with mighty men and all kinds of warriors, declares the Lord God.
Yeah. The idea that God is trying to give us about this sacrificial feast is when he slays Gog with his great sword, he's going to summon a sword, he's going to slay Gog, and when he falls on the mountains of Israel with all of his hosts and all of his armies, all of them, he's calling to the birds of the air, the beasts of the field, come, I have prepared this sacrificial offering for you. Eat the blood of these men. Drink their blood. I mean, it's really dark. It's really dark, but this is God's judgment on when this man, leads the surrounding nation against his people to wipe them off the map. It is the judgment of God, and his judgments are righteous and just.
Yeah.
Okay? So he's literally said, I have prepared this sacrificial feast for you, okay, for these creatures. Guess what happens in Revelation?
Yeah.
The great supper of God. So when the beast is destroyed, it says right here, I saw an angel standing in the sun who cried in a loud voice to all the birds flying in midair, come, gather together for the great supper of God, so that you may eat the flesh of kings, generals, and the mighty, of horses and their riders, and the flesh of all the people, free and slave, great and small. So look at this, and look at how excited I am to show you guys this. Since the angel standing in the sun and he's telling all the birds of the air to come gather and eat the flesh of both the beast and the mighty men, who are they eating? They're eating both, you know, the Antichrist and his armies, right? Leviathan. And within Ezekiel 38, it's Gog, same person, right?
Yep.
So check this out. The great marriage supper of the Lamb. Okay. I saw the beast and the kings of the earth with their armies gathered to make war against him who was sitting on the horse and against his army. And the beast was captured, and with it the false prophet, who in its presence had done the signs by which he deceived those who had received the mark of the beast and those who worship its image. These two were thrown alive into the lake of fire that burns with sulfur, and the rest were slain by the sword that came from the mouth of him who was sitting on the horse, and all the birds were gorged with their flesh. This is the great marriage supper of the Lamb, tying it to the great feast of Gog and his horde. Okay, so most people, this is hilarious, bro.
Yeah, most people
are going to think that, you know, the marriage supper looks like this, right? Like some sort of dinner banquet in heaven.
Yeah.
That's not what it is, right? I mean, it's just ridiculous.
That's what it will look like. It will look like, I don't know, something out of a friggin' horror movie.
Yeah, something crazy.
And then again,
it's
God's righteous judgment. And in the sight of that judgment, the nations will see it. So it's something that, you know, that has been foretold, right? It's we see parallels of this with Gog. We explained how he's going to be brought up just as Leviathan's going to be brought up. All these parallels just lead up to this point where God is going to destroy his enemies, literally, on the mountains of Israel.
Great. Amen.
Yeah.
And so finally, here is towards the end of the video, so you can see the final connection, so you can know 100% it is Leviathan, who is Gog, who is the Antichrist. In Psalm 74, it was you who split open the sea by your power. You broke the heads of the monster in the water. It was you who crushed the heads of Leviathan and gave it as food to the creatures of the desert.
That's right.
Okay.
Yeah.
So same story, guys. You can't get away from it. You can't jump away from it. What this means, the significance of all of this, is that all of these beings are the same. They are drawn out with hooks by God. They lead a massive army. Sometimes they're personified as locusts. They blaspheme God and his dwelling, which is Israel. They try to destroy Israel in the last days. They're the king of the north. They're slain by God on the last day, and their flesh is given as a sacrificial offering to the beasts of the field and the birds of the air. Okay. So, who exactly is Leviathan? He is God's number one enemy from start to finish. Mm. What Bible prophecy has done, and what, unfortunately, I was telling Leroy this, is I think that Bible prophecy needs some sort of reformation, like the Protestant Reformation, right? Yeah. Because the Catholics, for thousands of years, they were just teaching whatever they wanted to teach, right? Mm-hmm. Preacher rapture, all, you know, all these things, indulgences. It took a reformation to, like, look, we're going to read the Bible, see what it says, connect everything together to reform the Catholics and become Protestants. This is what we need for Bible prophecy. Yeah. So when you understand and you harmonize, they're all the same being. It is the same enemy from start to finish. Okay, that's what it is. There's no, we don't need to separate Gog and make him a separate Russian leader, separate from the Antichrist. We don't need to do that. They're the same. Okay, but we ultimately know the end of the story. Okay, so when the 1,000 years are ended, Satan will be released from his prison, and he will come out to deceive the nations that are at the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them for battle. Their number is like the sand of the sea, the locust, the horde, the same thing. They marched up over the broad plain of the earth and surrounded the camp of the saints and the beloved city. But fire came down from heaven and consumed them. And the devil who has deceived them was thrown into the lake of fire and sulfur where the beast and the false prophet were, and they will be tormented night and day forever and ever.
Yeah.
Okay. Within the new heavens and the new earth, this is what's described after the defeat of this being. Okay. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea, the Tehom, the bottomless pit, the chaos, the deep, was no more. Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people. God himself will be with them as their God, and he will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And death shall be no more, neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away.